You know, each week we come into worship and we open up God's word with an expectation that God will meet us in it, that he will speak to us. And this morning is right in line with that. We open to the good news according to Luke. And today more than ever, we need to hear good news. We're going to read here in Luke chapter 13 about how Jesus came alongside a woman who was struggling. She was in tremendous pain. In many ways, she was grieving what could have been. And in the midst of her hopelessness, Jesus himself provides the presence and hope that she desperately desires. On a Sabbath, Jesus was teaching in one of the synagogues, and a woman was there who had been crippled by a spirit for 18 years. She was bent over and could not straighten up at all. When Jesus saw her, he called her forward and said to her, "Woman, you are set free from your infirmity." Then he put his hands on her, and immediately she straightened up and praised God. Indignant because Jesus had healed on the Sabbath, the synagogue leader said to the people, "There are 6 days for work, so come and be healed on those days, not on the Sabbath." The Lord answered him, "You hypocrites. Doesn't each of you on the Sabbath untie your ox or donkey from the stall and lead it out to give it water? Then should not this woman, a daughter of Abraham, whom Satan has kept bound for 18 long years, be set free on the Sabbath day from what bound her?" When he said this, all his opponents were humiliated, but the people were delighted with all the wonderful things that Jesus was doing. Now, the Sabbath is a huge deal for Jewish people. Even to this day, from the very first pages of the Bible, God set apart the seventh day, the Sabbath, to be a day of rest, of a relationship, and of worship. The Bible tells us by the seventh day, God had finished the work he had been doing. So on the seventh day, he rested from all his work. Then God blessed the seventh day and made it holy. He set it apart from the others because on it he rested from all the work of creating that he had done. So God set aside this Sabbath day from others because he rested from all the work he had done in creating the universe. Now, do you really think that God, who is all-powerful, all-knowing, omnipresent, do you really think he needs a nap? After all he did he string up a hammock, kick up his feet, and rest? Of course not. So you and I, we think that resting simply means recovering from work, to recover from being tired. So what do we do as a result? We count down the days to the weekend, right? We mark on our calendar how many weeks we have left until we go on vacation, right? We can't wait to relax. Now, this is not what God is talking about. This is not what God is doing. I saw something this week for the very first time, and it's something that is, to me, was profound and amazing. When you look at each of the first 6 days of creation, it says every day there was morning and there was evening. But on the seventh day, the Sabbath, there was no morning or evening. That means what God did on that first Sabbath still continues today. You see, God's very existence is Sabbath. It's rest. See, rest is not simply a time to recover from work. Rest is stepping back, looking at all that God is doing. It's being intentional about recognizing God's hand in the world. It's celebrating who he is, how he meets us, how he provides for our needs, how he's present for us in our grief. And when God commands us to rest, he is saying, I want you to live knowing that I am God. I want you to live knowing that I am in charge and that you can trust me. So release your cares to me. Let go of those things that are holding you back. Trust that I will continue to be there for you in every situation. So the Sabbath is a time to set down those things that we're carrying. For many of us today, it's grief. Sometimes what we're carrying are regrets, our worries, our anxieties, our what could have beens. And Jesus is inviting us today to allow God to lift those burdens off of us and fall into the arms of our Heavenly Father, who wants to restore us and renew us. See, this is such a great picture of what God wants for us, not just when we come here on a Sunday morning to set aside intentional time for worship, right? For prayer, for singing. But this is an attitude that we are invited to experience every day. I love the way that little Rosalie nestled into her mom and dad and reluctantly nestled into me. We all know what it's like to have that newborn to rest. There's one right up front right here resting with its bottle. It's a perfect image of Sabbathing. It's coming home from a long trip and your kids are excited to see you. They burst, you know, through the garage door and they just wrap themselves around your leg. It's knowing that you are safe. It's experiencing love, hope, grace, presence. So that's what God intended for us in Sabbath. But by the time of Jesus, the religious leaders had developed all these traditions and they had added all these rules when they were defining what it means to not work, what it means to live faithfully on the Sabbath. And specifically, they brought up all these kind of strict and at times silly rules about what constituted labor or what constituted work. As a result, the Sabbath had become more of a burden for people rather than the gift that God intended for it to be. And as a result, you know, we lost what it means, or we lost the idea of being comforted or resting in our Heavenly Father. So here's Jesus on the Sabbath, what would have been his church, teaching the people. And when he sees a woman who is struggling with a spinal condition that we know today as Marie Struble disease, he has compassion on her. He sees her. Now, trouble begins when with this specific disease. Trouble begins when your spine starts to hurt, and to compensate for the pain, you find that you experience a little relief if you can bend over a bit. And the more that your back hurts, the more you find yourself bending over until you're bending over and you can't even get up because your spine eventually fuses into this crooked position. And Jesus sees this woman who for 18 years has been struggling with this debilitating disease. Now, I want you to notice that whenever the Bible tells us that Jesus sees someone, it's not like he notices them or it's like a glancing look, but the implication is that Jesus looks into the very core of a person. Now, many others could see her, but they weren't really seeing her. They were seeing past her, right? Many judged her. What did she do to deserve that type of curse from God? But Jesus sees her pain. He sees her shame. He sees the disgrace that she experiences. He sees the struggle that she has experienced in so many aspects of her life because of this physical ailment. So here she is in the synagogue on the Sabbath because she wanted to live a life that honored God. And Jesus saw that. And I love that just as Jesus comes alongside her to heal her, he reaches out to touch her. See, many believe that touching someone who had been cursed by God was in essence making you unclean, was making you unwell. And nobody wanted to associate with someone who could potentially be cursed by God. Many other people would have been very reluctant to publicly identify with her, much less touch her. But Jesus doesn't care what other people think. He is concerned about her and how she is doing. So even before Jesus brings the healing to her body, Jesus meets her where she is. Jesus loves her. Jesus cares for her. Now, there's a question for us this morning. One of the questions is, you know, how do you and I identify with people who are hurting? Well, one of the ministries of our church is known as Stephen Ministry, and this is a ministry that some of you have been trained in, others of you have received care. And one of the trainings of Stephen Ministry really helps you to understand that there are three different ways that we connect with people that are hurting. The first is sympathy, the second is empathy, and the third is over-identification, and they're not in any particular order. So when we feel compassion for someone, when we see a need, we will fall into one of those three responses: sympathy, empathy, or over-identification. So, and the best way to understand these three is to imagine yourself walking alongside a storefront, and the storefront has puppies for adoption. Well, someone who is sympathetic to those puppies, they will go, "Oh," but they'll keep on walking. Someone who over-identifies with the puppies will happily go into the pet store, climb over the glass, get into the cage, and sit with that dog with no intentions to ever leave. But those who have empathy, they are people who come alongside. They're encouragers. They do something about the need that they see. And this is what Jesus does. This is how Jesus cares for people, right? Jesus identifies with her in her pain. He saw her in a way that nobody else did, and he calls her forward in church. He invites her to come and to be with him. He reaches out, he touches her, he heals her. And when that happens, it says that she straightens up. Now, when the synagogue leader sees all this, you know, nonsense in his worship service, he's furious. "Hey, Jesus, this isn't in the order of worship. You know, we didn't plan on this happening." And he could say, "Yeah, I get it. I know, Jesus. I know that if someone, right, there's a life and death situation and there's a need, I know on the Sabbath we can kind of bend that rule, we can make it, you know, we can do something about it, but come on, Jesus, it's been 18 years, you could have waited till Monday." Jesus, he scolds the religious leaders. "So you're just a bunch of hypocrites, right? You have no problem taking your animals out to get them water, walking them to the field to get them fed. But right in front of you is one of God's children, one of God's beloved who has a need, and you want to ignore it." Think about this woman's suffering because of her condition. Like, you get the sense that all she could ever do day in and day out is look down at her broken body. All she could do is be consumed visually with what is wrong with her. And this is exactly what the evil one wants us to do. He wants us to focus only on ourselves, only on our pain, to think that we're not good enough, that we're not worthy of being loved by God, that our grief and even our pain, that it will have the last word. But this is not what your Heavenly Father wants for you. And this is precisely why Jesus came. See, Jesus, he breaks into our hopelessness. He breaks into our depression. He breaks into our pain. He breaks into our grief. He breaks into our questions. And he loves us. He comes alongside us. He cares for us. And in his time, heals us. And I love that when the woman is healed, she immediately straightens up and she starts praising. Maybe she dances, right? Maybe she goes around telling other people about what is happening. But from this hunched over woman, not being able to see anyone's face for a long time, the very first thing she sees when she stands up was the loving face of her Creator, the one that came to set her free. And in his presence and in his power and in his love, she found rest. And her response is, thanks be to God. It's worship. It reminds me of the words of the psalmist. These could have been her words. I waited patiently for the Lord. He turned to me and heard my cry. He lifted me out of the slimy pit, out of the mud and the mire. He set my feet on a rock and gave me a firm place to stand. He put a new song in my mouth. Couldn't you hear this coming out of this woman? A hymn of praise to our God. Many will see and fear the Lord and put their trust in him. This woman could not contain her joy. She could not help but respond to God's healing touch through Jesus with worship. And in her celebration of who God is and all that God has done, what was she doing? She was Sabbathing. She was resting. She had curled up into the arms of her Heavenly Father. This reminds me of another time when a group of people are bent over, not because of physical pain, but because of grief, feeling hopeless, devastated, angry that God had not shown up for them at their timing. John tells us that Jesus received word that Lazarus, one of his good friends, was very sick. Eventually, Jesus made his way to Lazarus's home, but when Jesus arrived, it was too late, and Lazarus had already died. And Martha, one of Lazarus's sisters, came out to meet Jesus. She's overwhelmed. She's bent over with grief. And when she gets face to face with Jesus, in her anger, in her emotions, in her grief, she lays into him. Where were you? If you had only been here sooner, my brother would not have died. And Jesus, though he could have, he doesn't fire back at her. Do you know who you're talking to? He doesn't do that. But Jesus, he sees her, right? He has empathy and compassion for her. The Bible tells us that he cries with them. But then he speaks into her grief. Martha, your brother will live. And, you know, Martha grew up in Sunday school. She goes, yeah, I know. I know one day God will come and everything will be set right. But Jesus says, I don't think you understand. I don't think your expectations are big enough. And he clarifies God's promises for her. Jesus says, I am the resurrection and the life. I'm not talking about a future hope. I'm talking about me here today. Because I am the resurrection and the life, those who believe in me, even though they die, they will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this? This was a moment of truth. As Jesus offered her not just words of hope, but Jesus offers her his very presence himself. Now, this did not take away the pain of the loss, but it brought something new into the story. Then just like the woman in the synagogue who straightens up and worships when Jesus heals her, Martha says to Jesus, "Jesus, I believe in you and I trust you." And with it, her perspective is forever altered. Her life is changed and she can't contain her newfound peace. And she heads back to tell her sister Mary the news. Each of these women that Jesus meets is struggling to see the hand of God in their lives. They're bent over with grief and with pain. They're feeling hopeless that real healing, that peace, that joy is even possible. They're struggling to believe, are God's promises really true? Yet Jesus comes alongside them, sees them, and offers them hope. How many of us can relate to these women? Right? How many of us feel like we're bound by something? Something that's keeping us off the eyes of our Heavenly Father. Something that's weighing us down. And maybe it is grief. Maybe it's a health condition. Maybe it's a relationship. Maybe it's your finances. There's something in your life that you're struggling to get out from under. Or you're challenged to see God's hand and how might God intervene. Well, this past Thursday, our church family experienced one of its worst days as we heard the news that little Anna Calkins, 9 years old, was tragically taken from us, and from our perspective, way too early. For days, our community has mourned her death. Our church family has had our hearts ripped out. Understandably, her family is devastated. And so many of us have found ourselves bent over, grieving, asking if we can ever move beyond the pain. As we think about little Alyssa, as we think about her not being a part of worship this morning when the kids are going to sing, as we think about her not being in Sunday school alongside the other children, as we mourn the fact that we won't see her grow up, become a young woman, to grow into her faith, we are reminded of what we learn about the life and ministry of Jesus. That Jesus sees us. He comes alongside us and cares for us. He invites us to look for him, find rest in him, and trust him, reminding us time and time again that you and I are not God, but he is. That he is the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in him will never die. That he is the one who has come to not only meet us in our pain, but he is the one who can bring true healing. That Jesus has come to lift us up, to take off the burdens that we carry so that we might stand tall once again, see the face of God, and see that he is big enough to handle anything that we might face. And as I was even personally struggling with Alyssa's death, struggling with my own grief, sitting in the living room there with the family and their own devastation, talking to so many of you who loved her, served her, taught Sunday school with her, or in the class that she was in, I was feeling bent over, weighed down. And it was there that God met me. He reminded me of his hope and his presence, even in death. On Friday morning, I had a conversation with Marie, one of our children's director, and she shared with me that just a few months ago, little Alyssa, at 9 years old, gave her life to Jesus Christ for the very first time. Amen. Amen. This is something that her grandparents had been praying over her since the moment that they found out that little Alyssa was going to be born. This is something that our church prays about. There are little children, those who'll be singing here in just a few minutes, would come to know the love and the saving grace of Jesus. So here I am in the midst of these tears of grief, of thinking about the crushed hopes and dreams that Alyssa's parents and grandparents had for her. Here it was, I got this glimmer of hope and some peace because I know that because of her faith, because of God's grace, her death, this side of heaven is not the end of her story. And I know that for so many of you, whether it was this event or another time, the glimmer of hope that we find in the person, the ministry, and the love of Jesus allows us to face the day and turn to God, even when everything inside of us says it's impossible. The Bible tells us that because of God's grace, that anyone who puts their faith in the person of Jesus Christ will live. And we know that like all those who've gone before us in Jesus, little Alyssa is alive today. And one day we will see her again in a place long prepared for her, a place that Jesus calls our home. So how would he invite us to experience Sabbath rest with him today? What is it that we need to hear from him? Well, first, I believe that Jesus, he would grieve with us. He would sit with us in our pain, in our questions. Then he would remind us about who our God is. He would remind us that there is more. He would share with us about God's promises. He would tell us about our Heavenly Father's power and his love. And then he would invite us to Sabbath, to rest in God's presence. Into every situation where it looks like the light of day will never come, where it looks like evil will have the last word, when it feels like the pain will never subside, Jesus enters and speaks words of comfort and hope so that you and I may be set free from that which has kept us bound. Might we be a church that doesn't just place our full faith in the person, in the work, in the ministry of Jesus, but might we be a people who place our faith and trust and learn as we become people who have the faith and trust of Jesus, living as he did, knowing that there is no morning and no evening, no sense of beginning and no end when we are resting in the Lord. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the model and ministry of Jesus, the way that he broke into this world, a world overcome by evil and darkness and despair, and brought good news to the woman in the synagogue, to the family grieving the loss of a loved one. We God, pray that we would have the perspective that you are breaking into this place today, that we would sense your peace, your presence, that we would know your comfort, we would know your love, and that we'd rest in your arms, trusting that you work all things for the good of those who love you. God, we take great comfort in knowing that death does not have the last word, but you will. Our sin doesn't have the last word, but you will. Any sense of brokenness in the world will not have the last word, but you do. And that is, I am making all things new. Trust me. Believe in me. Rest in me. Amen. morning, for many months, we had planned on having the children lead us in worship. Now, obviously, after the events of this last week, that was a tall order. In light of the fact that little Alyssa was not going to be present in her position up front, leading us this morning. So the other evening when I was spending time, Caitlin and I went over to spend time with Kurt and Anna, one of the questions that I had for them was, knowing that this church, in their words, meant so much to Alyssa, knowing that your love for the Lord and love for her meant so much to Alyssa, knowing that being in the children's choir as a ministry leader meant so much to Alyssa, would you feel comfortable with us continuing and having them sing this morning? And they said, absolutely. I said, we need to know that death that we experience this side of heaven is not the end of the story. While it might be a dark chapter, God is not done. And we need to hear there is hope, even as we leave this place today. And I want to just take a minute. I had the privilege of seeing Alyssa's room, her unmade bed. And her grandma took me around and showed me all the places that her toys that she loved, her little shoes, artwork that she had made. And she says, but Andrew, I want you to notice this. I want you to notice all the little crafts from the Sunday school that had been given to her. It all scattered out the room were little crafts that many of you had helped her make. And she showed me her little Bible. And here it is, the Bible. When I opened it up, this Bible says, presented to Alyssa Calkins by Darden Presbyterian Church. She said she read this Bible each week. Whenever she went to Sunday school, she would come home that afternoon. They'd review the lesson, and then because she didn't have any siblings, she would teach the Sunday school lesson to her little puppy. And I want you to know, the reason we do what we do, the reason why we're here, the reason why we give, we serve, is because of people, little children like Alyssa, because of our children here, because of one another. Because this world needs to know there's hope. This world needs to know that Jesus has come to break into our darkness, to restore, to redeem, and to bring us to life. So this morning, as our kids lead us in worship, may we celebrate that God is on the move. May we celebrate that God is alive, that we can trust in him. And may we be committed to his mission and work in the world.
We don't live as people with no hope, but our hope is in Jesus. Our hope is in King Jesus, who rules and reigns today and forever. Let's never forget that. We do have some resources available and some counselors. If you would like to maybe process a little bit of what's going on in your life, this situation or others, and they are in the parlor, you're welcome to make your way down there. There's, in addition to counselors, we have some resources available for you to either take home or tools if you want to know how to talk to others and maybe even your children about the events of the last few days. And may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord's face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. And may the favor of the Lord be upon you. And may you know his love, his care, his compassion, his empathy, and his peace.